We have extraordinary panel here, and they all have achieved. We are very humbled to have all of you, and they had extraordinary work and impacting hundreds of lives, and they're all self-made people we have. So I'll not take too much time. I'll briefly introduce. You have a detailed bio. My friend Ramji, we know from last 8-9 years. He was a Citibank working in London, and God knows what happened in one day, and he ended up in India and working on science education. How the lot of in rural India, how we can spark the curiosity among the children. And you have seen some of the presentation, and we have a mobile van. You can see it. Ramji, then we have Chaudhryji. He is a self-made guy from Jaipur, and Jaipur Rux. I don't know, everyone knows Jaipur Rux, and more than 50,000 weavers he has been working and impacted all the middlemen, etc. I'm sure he'll tell in his story. Then we have Devashish Mitter. He's heading the Dell Foundation in India and providing the strategic thought process to their work, from investing to different social entrepreneurship, NGO, to the strategic partnership with the government like Haryana and Rajasthan, where systematic change can be facilitated. Then we have Dr. Shaili Batra. She is like a doctor, but got passionate about the tuberculosis and working from the slum Delhi, now in multiple countries, and have a wonderful system. How the TB, like major problem in the TB that you identify in a late, but you the follow-up is very bad, and then a lot of patient die. But her processes, system, organization, design in a certain manner, so the follow-up happen along the process. And my friend Satya, his education company, Satya Narayan. It's a very interesting insight. He has built a company from PEP test to a lot of now like a K-12 regular education. And he has built a company from the scratch where it's a very competitive market, but he has a revenue model which is kind of scaling up, and they're growing companies. So that's a brief, but the whole format is that each one of them will tell their story. What is it? What is their personal and organizational story, 5 minutes, and then we can do the Q&A. So Shelley, we'll start from you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for this opportunity. And my story is very simple. I'm a doctor, I was operating people, and 10 years back I realized that it's not enough to make money. And as Robert Frost said in his poem, the roads diverged in a wood, and I could see the road less traveled. So on one hand, there was a lot of money, a lot of recognition, and a lot of glamour in the medical profession. And on the other hand, there was only suffering, and there was a lot of hard work. So I chose that, and I chose that deliberately. And I'm happy I did so, and I haven't looked back since then. So I chose TB as my focus for two reasons. Number one, it's the biggest health problem in India and the world. It's the biggest infectious disease killer. And number two, nobody knows and nobody cares. All over the world, people say TB, it went out with the plague. In India, politicians say, when we got rid of the Angrez, we got rid of TB. But there are 20 million cases in the world every 2 years, 9 million new cases. 30% in India, we are the TB factory of the world exporting it. We're not just exporting medical and technical expertise. So what is the challenge? When the infrastructure is there, the challenge was that patients have to go every day for 6 months to a designated center. Now the government hospitals are few and far between. They are miles away. They are open 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Are the poor people going to work and get food for the family, or are they going to go for TB treatment day after day? And where is the bus fare coming from? Who's going to take care of the stigma? Who's going to follow up? Where is the love and compassion? To solve the problem, I said, let's take TB treatment to the doorsteps of the disadvantaged, so no one has to miss work and wages in order to get the treatment. And let us utilize, as the previous panelists have talked about, the grassroots infrastructure, the bottoms-up approach. There are temples everywhere, there are gurdwaras. The first prayer is at 6:30 in the morning. So we took the boxes of medicines from the doctors, and we have this partnership with the public-private partnership with the government, and kept it in the temples, in the gurdwaras, in the clinics of the quacks. And little children going to school stop there, get their medicine. No one needs to know, their privacy is maintained. And factory workers working the late night shift, they come back at 9 p.m., get the medicine. No one needs to know. and we have a cadre of health workers supporting it. If a patient doesn't come for the treatment, the health worker who belongs to the same community, speaks the same language, eats the same food, that person is responsible for navigating the informal geography of the slum areas and finding the patient and giving the treatment. So far, so good. I was very happy till I realized there could be a lot of hanky-panky going on, a lot of data fudging. The health workers, are they doing the work? Are they going? Are they not going? Are the treatment cards just getting a tick for a whole month and no direct observation that has been recommended? And with that, we partnered with Microsoft Research in 2009 and developed e-compliance, a very simple system. Again, the technology was created bottoms up. The technology was not created in a fancy lab and dumped in the slums and villages. It was made with the people who are going to implement the technology, who are going to use the technology. In the slums of New Delhi, the technology device was created. A very simple tablet with a fingerprint reader attached. All patients registered by fingerprint. Every time the patient meets the provider, takes the medicine, fingerprint taken. In real time, we get to know if the patient hasn't come. Health worker goes to the patient's house. By GPS tracking, we know. Fingerprint proof of visit again, and incentives given for all this. We started this work 10 years back with one center, and from one center in New Delhi, we are the biggest NGO in India. We are working in 7-8 countries. And thank you very much. I'm truly humbled by all the kindness that I have received from the people here. And one thing I want to add over here is that it's not about recognition and awards. Recognition matters. It's work that matters. It's people that matter. It's patients that matter. And when a patient gets better, nothing can beat the happiness, as other doctors in the audience will know. A patient gets better, it's not just health. It's food on the table. It's children going to school. In India, 100,000 women are thrown out of homes every year because of TB. We are taking care of stigma. We are saving jobs for TB patients. We are creating jobs for the disadvantaged. And I think that is the biggest success, that the people are benefiting by our program.
So he said I was at Citibank, but I wasn't fired. And it was much before the meltdown, okay? But anyway, so, you know, you end up doing whatever you want to do in life, right? And you deal with the consequences, good or bad. And when I was a kid, I had a dream of building a school for creative leaders. How did I get the dream? I don't know. I went to a school founded by a very creative person called Jay Krishnamurti, and perhaps I was influenced by that. But I ended up in banking, and for many years, I was doing fairly well, and, you know, it's a good life. And I used to take the underground to work in London, and you know, people of my generation, we used to listen to a lot of Pink Floyd. Perhaps even you do. And there was that famous song, you know, Time, hanging on in quiet desperation is the English way. And I used to think, oh my God, have I become desperate like all these people in the underground, hanging on in quiet desperation? And I said, no, the time has come to do what I want to do. So I said, we'll go back to India and build a school. So we built, we acquired like 200 acres of land where we would build a school. And that was the good news. The bad news was we ran out of money. It turned out to be good news in hindsight, because it forced us to think that if the money isn't there and you've got the land and the government is breathing down your throat saying, where are the buildings? Is this a scam? And we huddled and we came up with the idea of a mobile lab, at least to do something. I'd quit my job, the phone wasn't ringing, so you had to be busy. And so we started with one mobile lab in the villages. That attracted a lot of attention. And all of a sudden, I said, you know, maybe this is as good, if not a better idea, than building a school for brilliant kids, whatever that means, that reach out to the rural kids. And so we were just pulled gravitationally in that direction, and one mobile became 4 and 5 and 10, and the system began to grow. And then slowly money began to filter in, because people saw that we were engaged doing something innovative, and into the campus, and we began to build in a step-by-step way different centers, physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics, art, astronomy, and so on. And of course, ecology. The land was barren when we acquired it, And today it's become a kind of ecological preserve, thanks to the good work done by a lot of people from Bangalore and other places. So today we have like 175 mobile labs, about 50, 60 science centers, a whole bunch of labs on motorcycles, and the campus has turned out very well, and we're building some larger centers in Karnataka with a lot of partners. So it's been a very exciting journey, and as Desh said, you know, it's the journey that I suppose anyone who builds anything, you have the ups and downs of doing that, whether you're painting a painting or creating a campus or innovating something new. That's been the experience, and I have no regrets, and we've learned a lot, and perhaps during the Q&A we can share some of that. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Naveen. So I represent Michael and Susan Dell Foundation. This is actually a family foundation. Actually, there's a separate Dell Foundation, which is the CSR of the Dell company. We are the family foundation set up by Michael and Susan. And the mission of the foundation is to transform lives of children living in urban poverty through education, health, and better family economic condition. So our work spans essentially as obviously education, which is from primary to secondary, school completion, college admission, college completion. So like all of us in this room, we dream that every poor child will become an engineer and doctor, the way I think Ramji is talking about. But we know that that's one part of the work. But the second part is, what happens to those who can't make stay on that ladder of education? So we are actively in the space of job-oriented skills, and we have a pretty large portfolio of that. And lastly, we are in the space of financial products that can actually improve the financial well-being as well as income-generating capability of slum population. I'll not go into all the details. I'm happy to talk about it when we have the break. But I will focus on the education piece, and I'll just talk about that. While we are a venture philanthropy approach, so that which means that we invest through equity in social enterprises, we give commercial debt to social enterprises, as well as we have a very large portfolio of grants where it is appropriate. And I'll just focus on one of those things, and which is essentially we are working to transform large-scale systemic education transformation at state levels. The first one that has been reasonably successful is in Haryana, where there are 15,000 primary schools. In school education, in terms of scaling, which is the topic of discussion today, we do believe that it's bottoms up only will not work. School education system cannot be changed one teacher at a time, one school at a time. It requires a systemic governance and a systemic top-down approach, while of course working to make sure that the transactions at a one teacher, one child level also get saved. So in that, what type of organization, we are talking about organization, what type of organization do we believe in? So we believe that the systemic transformation needs to be first of all owned and led by the government. So in Haryana, and now we have just launched in Rajasthan. Incidentally, it won't come as a surprise to all of you, these are the only two states where systemic statewide transformations are happening. This requires a governance structure where it is led by the chief minister, education secretary, chief secretary level. Because there is no way we can try our level best to train a teacher over and over again. That teacher will never be successful if up and down the entire organization structure, she's not supported to do her job. So we actually believe that the failure in the education system, at least in the government, is not a problem of teacher not doing their job. It's not a problem of pedagogy being a problem. Those are issues. But actually, it's a management failure. And a management failure has to be solved through a management structure. So what we do in that case is we start in any of these projects, any of these initiatives, through a very large coalition of intervention supporters. So I think we were talking about how do NGOs collaborate. This is another very, I think, unique structure which I would encourage all of you to take a look at, where multiple NGOs are playing their specific roles, which is the best role they can play. But it is driven by, it starts with developing a multi-year, multi-stakeholder, detailed blueprint of how a state education system should be transformed. And then comes the point of then how does that get governed? So it has to be governed by, at the topmost level of the state, with the chief, either the chief minister, which is happening very actively in Rajasthan, or in Haryana by the chief secretary, really running this whole program of their own. And then all of us come in to support and provide the specific inputs that are required to make sure government's efforts are successful. So I can go into more details, Naveen, and later on probably during question answer session, but I thought scale in the, at least in the education system, particularly when it comes to government system, requires a top-down organizational structure to start, sustain, and deliver learning level impacts.
Thank you, Devish. Satya, what is your story?
Thank you, Naveen, and you had shared a very detailed mail with all of us, which kind of gives the rules that we should not violate. So I've just made a note of it. So Naveen had asked us to share about the idea, the execution part of it, and the challenges and opportunities. So I'll just kind of cover using this format. I've been active in the area of education for the last 22 years now. Started with a space, what is called as coaching, test preparation to get into the leading business schools, IITs, medical schools, and all of that. We moved into vocational space, so we partner with various state governments to make the rural youth employable in about 50 trades, as they call it, areas of skills. We run schools. We have about 12 campuses. It goes in the name of Indus World School. We do publishing. So in each of these, the connection that I see is that the idea was to do a mix of inside out, which is what we would like to do as entrepreneurs running the company, to an outside in as an opportunity that makes sense. And we've all started off penniless as entrepreneurs long ago, so we had to do everything as a viable entity, viable activity. However, over a period of time, some of these activities have taken the shape of so-called not-for-profit, but it still has to be viable because you are putting your credibility at stake. You want to make it work for the people who are sponsoring it, whether it's the government or a corporate entity. And maybe I'll focus on the last part where I'm spending a lot of my time now. Having done schools, vocational training, test prep, all of that, one area that we have picked up now is in the area of innovation inside schools and colleges, and that's where it goes, it just takes it a step ahead, Ramji, where we talk about how we need to empower our students, enable them to become knowledge creators and not people who cram and go and deliver and come back. Getting into an IIT is important, getting into an IIM is important, and you need to crack those exams because that's the structure given to us. But we help students in schools and colleges to become knowledge creators, to do research, and take it either in the direction of publishing their own papers, patents, etc., or to convert that into startups. That's an area that we are trying to scale up. It's a very hard task. The challenge part that Naveen asked me to cover. The challenge is the mindsets. Schools and colleges think that they are very, very busy. Their calendars are chock-a-block full. The heads of the departments don't have time. And if you come to an eminent place like an IIT or an IIM, they say that, we have seen it for the last 60 years, so you guys can't teach us what is innovation. So we beg them and say that, so we want to turn it on its head and make a 19-year-old do research. A 55-year-old doing research, of course, is a done thing, but can a 19-year-old come out with his own patents? Can a grade 9 child write a concept paper? And you'll be very surprised, we have had children writing a concept paper on edible vaccines. That's what a child asked the question. And then that got published, and the child went all the way to a conference in San Diego, came back from a government school in Hyderabad. And I think that's what is the excitement in my life right now. We think we can, I think beautifully said in the quote of G.D. Birlaji that you gave, I think you were giving 79 quote. I think we also have some kheer getting pakaud in India. We are an understated 2 trillion economy. I think we are actually in a 10 trillion economy, and I love the Rosling's story where he says that 2047 it'll be the largest economy. But I think where I would like to kind of focus on is that a society is much larger than an economy. Its economy sits on top of it. The society, the family, the relationships, and that's what is the most beautiful thing I believe is about India. We shouldn't look at ourselves as an economy. Economy is one metric. We will go after that to kind of crack the global chart sheet, to game the game. But I think we should preserve all the strengths of India as a society and do fundamentally good stuff where the world's center of gravity comes here in another 50 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, हमारे साथ चौधरी जी हैं. He is a excellent speaker. And his storytelling in 5 minutes is a very tough thing. So I request Chaudhary ji to tell the Jaipur Rug and his personal story.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद नवीन जी. देखिए मैंने 38 साल पहले बीकॉम करने के बाद में अपनी करियर की शुरुआत एक दुकान से की जो मेरे पिताजी चलाते थे. लेकिन जब मैं दुकान पे काम करता था तो उसमें मेरा मन नहीं लगता था. तो मैंने सोचा ऐसा मैं कुछ करूं जो मेरे को अच्छा लगे. तो उस वक्त इंडिया में कारपेट बनाने की वीवर बहुत कम थे, लेकिन कारपेट की मांग बहुत अच्छी थी. तो मैंने सोचा मैं ये काम शुरू करूं तो मुझे गांव में जाने का मौका मिलेगा. तो मैंने अपने पिताजी से 5000 रुपये उधार लिए, 2 लूमें खरीदी, एक पुरानी साइकिल खरीदी और 9 वीवरों के साथ 38 साल पहले इस कारपेट बिजनेस की शुरुआत की. जब मैंने ये धंधे को शुरू किया तो सारे जो काम करने वाले लोग थे वो अनटचेबल क्लास के थे, अछूत लोग थे. तो परिवार वाले, मोहल्ले वाले, दोस्त सब बोले कि आप तो अछूत लोगों के साथ काम करते हो, हम आपको ये बिजनेस नहीं करने देंगे. लेकिन उस वक्त मैंने देखा कि एक आदमी की पहचान जाति से कैसी हो सकती है. एक आदमी की पहचान तो उसके कर्मों से होनी चाहिए. तो जो लोग मेरा विरोध करते थे वो मेरे को रिजेक्ट करते गए और मेरा वीवरों से इतना ज़्यादा प्रेम बढ़ता चला गया कि मैं अपना पूरा समय वीवरों के साथ गुजारता था, खाना भी उन्हीं के साथ खाता था. तो 8 साल तक मैंने जॉब वर्क किया. जॉब वर्क करने के बाद फिर मैं जयपुर आया और वहाँ पर मैंने अपने भाई के साथ मिलकर एक्सपोर्ट कंपनी की शुरुआत की. तो उस वक्त कारपेट की मांग इतनी ज़्यादा थी कि मैं पूरा सप्लाई नहीं कर पा रहा था. तो फिर मुझे पता चला कि गुजरात के एक ट्राइबल एरिया में सरकार काफ़ी लोगों को ट्रेनिंग दे रही है. मैं वहाँ उस एरिया में गया, वहाँ मैंने देखा. जब उस एरिया में गया तो लोगों ने बोला कि ये ट्राइबल, उस वक्त 20-25% लोग तो पहनते थे वहाँ पर, तो लोग बोलते थे आप वहाँ जाओगे तो आपको काम नहीं करने देंगे, आपका फर्ज छीन लेंगे, आपकी पिटाई कर देंगे. लेकिन मुझे मालूम था कि लोगों को प्रेम करके, लोगों को प्रेम दे के उनसे बहुत कुछ करवाया जा सकता है. तो फिर मैं 8 साल उस ट्राइबल एरिया में रहा और करीब 15,000 ट्राइबल लोगों को मैंने कारपेट वीविंग में तैयार किया. फिर 99 में उस वक्त मेरे क्या है कि 3 बेटियां थी, दो बेटे थे. तो पहली बेटी ने बोला कि पापा मैं अमेरिका पढ़ने के लिए जाऊंगी. तो मुझे तो मालूम नहीं था कि अमेरिका होता क्या है और कैसे वो वहाँ पढ़ने के लिए जाएगी. फिर मेरा एक अंग्रेज दोस्त था तो उसने बोला कि आप अपनी बेटी को अमेरिका पढ़ने के लिए भेजिए, क्योंकि जब वो पढ़ लिख के आएगी यूएस इज ए टोटली डिफरेंट वर्ल्ड. तुम जिस तरह सोचते हो, जिस तरह काम करते हो, तो ऐसी बहुत सारी चीज़ें जो तुम जानते नहीं हो. तो कह रही तुम्हारी बेटी पढ़ लिख के जब वापस आएगी सिविल में के बिग बिग डिफरेंस, तो अपने तीनों बेटियों को वहाँ पढ़ने के लिए भेजा, दोनों बेटों को भी वहीं पढ़ने के लिए भेजा। फिर 99 में मैं अपने भाई से सेपरेट होकर मैंने जयपुर कंपनी की शुरुआत की, और जयपुर कंपनी की शुरुआत बिल्कुल जीरो से की मैंने। और पहले 3 साल में मेरे को इतनी भारी परेशानी आई कि जितना भी मैंने पैसा कमाया 20 साल में पूरा उसमें खो दिया, क्योंकि मैंने गांव में काम किया था तो मुझे नहीं मालूम था अकाउंट क्या होता है, फाइनेंस क्या होता है, एचआर क्या होता है, ब्रांडिंग क्या होती है, मार्केटिंग क्या होती है, सप्लाई चेन क्या होती है, मैंने तो कभी सुना भी नहीं था। तो जब 3 साल मुझे तकलीफ आई तो मैंने इंट्रोस्पेक्शन किया कि मेरे से क्या गलती हो गई, क्योंकि कारपेट की क्वांटिटी और क्वालिटी बनाने में पूरे दुनिया में मेरा नाम था, और जब मैंने एक बिजनेस शुरू किया तो मैंने क्या गलती की। तो जब मैंने इंट्रोस्पेक्शन किया तो मुझे पता चला कि मेरा जो कारपेट का सक्सेस था उससे मुझे फॉल्स फीलिंग ऑफ गुडनेस, थोड़ा अहंकार आ गया मुझे, जिसको अपने यूफोरिया भी बोलते हैं। फिर मैंने धीरे धीरे अपने आप में सुधार करना शुरू किया, फिर मैंने अपने सोच को बदला, अपनी आदतों को बदला, और मुझे समझ में आया कि एक ग्लोबल बिजनेस चलाने के लिए एक कारपेट बनाना एक अलग चीज़ है और एक ग्लोबल बिजनेस बनाना एक अलग चीज़ है। फिर मैंने किताबें पढ़ना शुरू किया, सोचना शुरू किया, बड़े सक्सेसफुल लोगों से मिलना शुरू किया, और बिल्कुल जीरो से जयपुर शुरू किया, और आज देश की मतलब कारपेट बनाने की हैंड नोटेड की एक लीडिंग कंपनी है, 40,000 वीवर इससे जुड़े हुए हैं, 85% महिलाएं हैं इसमें काम करने वाली, 40 देशों में एक्सपोर्ट होता है, और अभी हमने कुछ बहुत नई, और हम क्या है कि डायरेक्ट वीवर से काम करते हैं, उसकी कैपेबिलिटी डेवलप करते हैं, उसकी लीडरशिप कंटिन्यू डेवलप करते हैं। अभी हमने जो पिछले 2-3 सालों में जो ताज़ा जो इनिशिएटिव लिए हैं, एक दो इनिशिएटिव में अंत में आपको बताना चाहूँगा, हमने देखा कि गांव के अंदर जो काम करने वाली महिलाएं हैं उनकी जो विजडम है, उनकी जो स्किल्स हैं, उनकी जो इंटेलिजेंस है वो रिमार्केबल है। तो हमने देखा कि उन महिलाओं में बहुत क्रिएटिविटी है, तो उन महिलाओं को बोला कि आप अपने डिज़ाइन के कारपेट बनाइए, हम आपको डिज़ाइन नहीं देंगे। उन्होंने अपने डिज़ाइन के कारपेट बनाए और आज वो कारपेट दुनिया में इतने फेमस हो रहे हैं कि अभी आने वाले समय में 20% प्रोडक्शन केवल उन वो महिलाएं अपनी डिज़ाइन के कारपेट का करेगी। दूसरा, अभी एक नई इनिशिएटिव शुरू हुई कि हम जो हमारे व्यूवर हैं उनकी हर कारपेट के साथ एंड कंज्यूमर को कहानी बता रहे हैं, तो हमारा जो व्यूवर डायरेक्ट एंड कंज्यूमर से जुड़ जाएगा, और जब एंड कंज्यूमर और व्यूवर जब इमोशनली कनेक्ट हो जाएंगे तो मुझे लगता है कि एक बहुत अच्छे वेल्थ हम लोग क्रिएट कर पाएंगे। एक हमने तीसरी चीज़ की कि हमारी जितनी जो व्यूवर महिलाएं थी उन महिलाओं में से हमने करीब 20 महिलाओं को चुना जिन्होंने कभी अपने घूंघट के बाहर मतलब झांके भी नहीं देखा होगा। उन महिलाओं को हमने क्वालिटी सुपरवाइज़र बनाया, ब्रांच मैनेजर बनाया। अब उसमें से कुछ ऐसी महिलाएं हैं जो बहुत जल्दी आने वाले 1-2 साल में हमारे कुछ डिपार्टमेंट की हेड बन के हमारे कॉरपोरेट ऑफिस में भी आएगी। धन्यवाद।
मैंने बताया था 5 मिनट इज़ वेरी टफ फॉर हिम, क्योंकि आई हैव हर्ड हिम अर्लियर इन हुबली डीडी, इट वॉज फैबुलस द हाउ मेनी लाइफ गॉट टच एंड इम्प्रूव। सो आई ओपन फॉर द, आई डोंट नीड टू ओपन, इट्स ऑलरेडी ओपन। यस सर।
नमस्कार। मैं पहले सवाल पूछ चुका, अपना परिचय बता चुका हूँ, भूपेंद्र चेतना से हूँ। मेरा सवाल मैम से है, मैम टीवी पे आप बहुत काम करते हैं, ऑपरेशन आशा जो है एक बड़ा नाम है एनजीओ सेक्टर में, लेकिन आज भी हिंदुस्तान में या पूरी दुनिया में भी अगर देखें तो रेलवे स्टेशन पे जो बच्चे रहते हैं वो एक अपने आप में बड़ी समस्या है, जिसको रेलवे मिनिस्ट्री और डब्ल्यूसीडी मिनिस्ट्री भी टारगेट करके नया काम करना शुरू कर रही है। लेकिन पिछले 9 साल से मैं इस सेक्टर में काम कर रहा हूँ, उन बच्चों के साथ काम कर रहा हूँ, आप उस समस्या को कब एड्रेस करेंगे और कब आपकी टीम, क्योंकि आपने बताया गुरुद्वारे में या रिलीजियस प्लेसेस पे आपने बताया कि एक बॉक्सेस होते हैं और सब कुछ वहाँ पे ट्रीटमेंट होता है, लेकिन कई बच्चों को मैंने देखा है जो टीवी से जो रेलवे स्टेशन पे अपनी लाइफ सर्वाइव करते हैं, पटरियों पे सोते हैं या आउटर एरिया में रेलवे में सोते हैं, लेकिन वो टीवी के पेशेंट बन जाते हैं। उनको इतना समझा के जब हम प्राइमरी हेल्थ सेंटर पे लेके जाते हैं, जैसा आपने बताया था कि प्राइमरी हेल्थ सेंटर पे जाना अपने आप में एक टफ होता है क्योंकि बच्चा काम करे, आपने एम्प्लॉयर्स का बताया था गरीब लोगों का, ऐसे बच्चों का है कि जो बच्चे रेलवे स्टेशन पे हैं वो घर नहीं जाते या वो अपने खुद कबाड़ा चुन के या भीख मांग के या झाड़ू लगा के काम करते हैं, तो वो कहते हैं कि हम जब ये करके वहाँ जाएंगे या न्यूट्रिशनल फूड उनको नहीं मिलता, तो किस तरीके से आपने क्या कभी उसके बारे में सोचा है, और अगर सोचा है तो अब तक शुरू क्यों नहीं किया, और अगर शुरू करने का प्लानिंग कर रहे हैं तो प्लीज़ आप बड़े रेलवे स्टेशन को छोड़ के छोटे रेलवे स्टेशन पर जाने की पहले कोशिश कीजिएगा। तो मेरा सवाल ये है कि इतना समय क्यों लगा इस आपके, इन बच्चों की अभी भी डेथ क्यों हो रही है?
So that's a very, very important question, that TB is so rampant and you are not doing sufficient. I would absolutely agree with you on that point. We have to really take the program to scale, because in our country, more than 2 lakhs of people are dying every year because of tuberculosis. And many of them are mostly, they are from children, from disadvantaged backgrounds, from slums, from tribal areas, from Naxalite areas, and the homeless children. So right in the beginning, when we started the slum project, we also started a mobile clinic in every area that we work, where we don't have the temples and gurudwaras, we have the mobile model. And there we have health workers who carry medicine in the backpack, and they go door to door. They go on foot, on motorcycles, and in Cambodia, even on boats, from island to island to meet with the homeless people and give them TB medication. So how they work typically is, we identify one person from that particular area, train that person in TB treatment, that person goes to the community and talks of the symptoms of TB. Do you have cough? Are you losing weight? Are you coughing up blood? Are you having loss of appetite? Do you have a TB patient in the vicinity? If so, come to us, we will help you. Then the health workers take that person, the homeless child, to the government hospital, get the test done, get the 6 months treatment allotted, and take 200 rupees from me as cash incentive for doing so. And then the day they finish the complete 6 months treatment for the child, again they get a cash incentive. So that work has been started long time back, and we have to take it to scale. You are very right about it.
Thank you. Hi sir, my question is from the sir from the Dell Foundation. Hi sir, my name is Sushant and I'm from Quest Alliance, and our organization is also working in field of education and employability. And we are for last 4 years working with the Bihar government in 990 schools of Samastipur district. So my question is that for last 4 years we are working with the different governments people like CRC, BRC, headmasters, teachers, and do lot of training for them. But the only thing that we are missing from them is the sense of ownership. In spite of lot of training, lot of initiatives that we have taken, there is the only way that we can do that. We call the SPD and SPD call the BO and put a harsh talk on them, and then they do the things. So instead of lot of things, since the sense of ownership is not there, due to which lot of things that governments people can do is not doing, and still the students are getting dropped out and going to the private schools. So how, my first question is how we can build that sense of ownership in the government people, if we have to work more with the government people. And so one more question I just want to add is regarding the youth, that most of the funders feel that they feel that if the student is employed, your program is successful. So what we believe that it's not only the employed, it's also how employable you make the people. So instead of, is it true that any program, youth program, is successful only if we get the students employed or if we make them employable as well? So these were the two questions. Thank you, sir.
Sure, it's a loaded question. Maybe we can take it offline and I can tell you. But I think the Bihar experience that you talked about, incidentally, you know, this work that we do in Haryana and Rajasthan, that has been informed by a lot of struggle we have had in the past, just like what you are doing. One of the things, so there are two aspects to this ownership issue. One is, in a government system, non-government entities can never drive ownership. The ownership has to come from the top of the organization. That has to be the political leadership, that has to be the bureaucratic leadership. So that's first and foremost. So BRCs, CRCs can try very hard. But what about BRC's boss? What about his boss, her boss? Ultimately, it goes up to the education minister or education secretary, What is it that in a person is holding his entire organization responsible for? What is the accountability metrics? What data do they look at? We know that in most cases, the education secretary, not because of any lack of intent, the only thing he tracks is, has midday meal served? Very important. But has he ever asked, what is the data about learning levels? He hasn't. So ultimately, it is about, therefore, that's why we go on saying it's a system. Okay? So one is that. Secondly, I think when we talk to a lot of school teachers, government school teachers, they often express a lot of frustration because they are at the receiving end of everybody coming and training them every day. So it's like they say that we are training fatigued because every NGO will come and give us somebody who has signed an MOU with some organized entity in the level of the government, allows them to come and train us. Training is not the issue. It is the whole, as I said, I can go into the details, but one has to look at it as a management structure. If I draw a parallel, it is like and a lot of corporate people are over here, and I'm a corporate background also. If you have a problem in an industrial company of profitability, you don't first thing say, let's go and train the shop floor worker. You might have a wrong product. You might be in a wrong management structure. The compensation structure might be. You are in a wrong market. So there is a whole lot of things that has to be changed. So combination of, so what in Haryana we have done is essentially the Haryana government has done is to change the entire organization's structure of the education department. Job roles have been changed. Their job description have been changed. What they're measured by, what data is used, all those have been changed. And we are seeing a very significant rise in the accountability because the teachers are seeing the system is now working towards making them successful rather than making them the scapegoat to say, you're not teaching, therefore the whole thing is coming to earth. Quickly moving to your second question about employability. We also very much focus on the data on employment. The reason is we haven't found a good way of measuring employability. At the end of the day, employability is a nice concept, but ultimately if the youth does not get a job to earn a living, then any employability is theoretical. So if there are ideas of how to measure employability, we'd love to hear. In the absence of that, we will measure, has the child or the youth been employed?
Thank you. I'm Jagriti from Vision. मैं बनारस में बनारस के slums as well as गांव में कुछ काम कर रही हूँ health और education को लेके, खासकर child right focus करके. मैम से और सर से दोनों से मेरा सवाल है. मैम से इसलिए पहले कि मैं वीवर्स के साथ काम करती रही हूँ, उनके बच्चों के साथ, उनकी महिलाओं के साथ. और बनारस में जो बनारसी साड़ी का काम करने वाली जो सबसे बड़ा एम्प्लॉयमेंट देने वाला सेक्टर भी है, बनारस का पहचान है, वहाँ पे जो ये टीबी की प्रॉब्लम है, मैंने बहुत अच्छे से वॉच किया है और देखा है कि बहुत बुरी भयंकर स्थिति में है वो. मेल न्यूट्रिशन और टीबी बुनकरों के बीच में सबसे ज़्यादा खतरनाक तरीके से फैली हुई है और उसकी वजह से और कम्युनिटीज़ भी प्रभावित हो रहे हैं. गवर्नमेंट सेक्टर का जहाँ तक हाल है, हम लोगों ने बच्चों का टेस्ट कराने की कोशिश की तो वो ये साबित होना उनके लिए बहुत बहुत क्रिटिकल हो जाता है कि बताएं कि अगर हमने 16 बच्चों का हमने खुद टेस्ट कराया तो गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल से जो अगर 13 बच्चे इन्फेक्टेड निकले तो पूरा डिपार्टमेंट हिल जाता है. तो वो फिर ये साबित करने की कोशिश करते हैं कि नहीं, ये है ही नहीं. और मेजर प्रॉब्लम ये है और हम लोगों को फिर जाना पड़ता है प्राइवेट सेक्टर में जाके, बड़ी मुश्किल से उन बच्चों के लिए ये अफोर्ड करना भी संभव नहीं है कि उनका इलाज कर सकें. डाटा जो डॉट सेंटर्स के भरोसे से छोड़ने की बात है तो दे डोंट हैव फूड, उनके पास प्रॉपर डाइट नहीं है तो वो डॉट सेंटर की एकलौती दवा से वो ठीक नहीं होते और फाइनली काफ़ी बड़ी संख्या में मौतें होती हैं. और इन्फेक्शन का कोई अभी तक हम मेजर नहीं कर पाए हैं कि कितनी बड़ी संख्या में बनारस में इन्फेक्टेड लोग हो रहे हैं और लगातार होते जा रहे हैं. तो ये एक बहुत साइलेंट इमरजेंसी जैसी सिचुएशन है. तो इस पर बहुत ज़्यादा बनारस में कम से कम जहाँ वीवर्स हैं और बाकी एरियाज़ में भी काम करने की ज़रूरत है सीरियसली. और आप करें तो मुझे अच्छा लगेगा. दूसरी भी बात मैं बोल दूं ताकि आप दोनों लोगों को भी आसानी होगी. दूसरा, एजुकेशन पे मैंने काम किया है और जो आप कह रहे हैं बिल्कुल एग्री करती हूं कि मैनेजमेंट की प्रॉब्लम सबसे बड़ी प्रॉब्लम है और रिसोर्सेज और उनके बीच में कोई लिंक नहीं बन पा रहा है. बहुत छोटी सी बात से स्टार्ट करूं कि आज भी ये मैनेजमेंट की प्रॉब्लम है कि हम लोगों ने पूरा कैंपेन चलाया कि आप बच्चों को जो ड्रेस पहना रहे हैं गवर्नमेंट स्कूल में, यहाँ भी एक बच्ची आकर बोली मुझे बहुत अखरता है कि वो खाकी वर्दी पहन के आते हैं, दे डोंट लाइक दिस कलर. हम लोगों ने बहुत अच्छे 20-25 स्कूलों में, प्राइवेट प्राइमरी स्कूलों में मैं काम कर रही हूँ अपने एरिया के, उनको एक्टिवेट करने के नाम पर, तो देखती हूँ उन बच्चों को वो कलर नहीं पसंद है बट वो ऊपर से थोपा गया और कोई सुनने वाला नहीं है. आप लिखते रहिए कि ये कलर चेंज होना चाहिए, ये स्टाइल चेंज होना चाहिए, गवर्नमेंट स्कूल और अट्रैक्टिव होने चाहिए, बट ये सारे सजेशंस कोलेबरेशन के बिना और उस लेवल पर बात करने के बिना रह जाते हैं. दूसरी चीज़, जो सबसे बड़ी चीज़ प्रॉब्लम आती है टीचर्स और हम लोगों के बीच में भी, कि रिटेंशन नहीं है. बच्चों का रिटेंशन क्यों नहीं हो पा रहा है, अट्रैक्शन क्यों नहीं बढ़ पा रहा है, वो देखने की जरूरत है. सबसे बड़ी क्राइसिस वहीं पे है कि बच्चे वहां से भाग रहे हैं क्योंकि उनका अट्रैक्शन नहीं है.
में हो सकते हैं
जी क्या? तो मैं वही पॉइंट पे आ रही हूं कि हम लोग इस प्रॉब्लम के साथ किस तरह से कोलैबोरेट कर सकते हैं कि वहां बच्चों का रिटेंशन बढ़े, उनके लिए लाइब्रेरी हो, उनके लिए और चीज़ें व्यवस्थित हों और साथ में जो मैनेजमेंट की अपनी जो प्रॉब्लम है उनकी इस तरह से दूर हो सके. और इन दोनों पे नहीं फोकस करेंगे तो ये कम से कम बनारस के शहरी इलाकों में जहां 200 स्कूल हैं वो बंद होने की स्थिति में हो जाएंगे और वो बहुत दुखद होगा. थैंक यू.
थैंक यू. इन एडिशन टू दैट आई वुड लाइक टू ऐड प्रॉब्ली फराम जी एंड शैली, यू रन अ बिग, ऑफ कोर्स इंडिया इज, इफ यू सी मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम इज ह्यूज एंड पीपल एक्सपेक्टेशंस इज ऑल्सो ह्यूज फ्रॉम द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. सो यू गाइज हैव स्टार्टेड वेरी हम्बली, but how you manage able to how you are able to scale that much, what are the some of the secret sauce can happen, so not only you build the organization but the several people sitting here, they can there also build their organization and solve these other problem, if you can pick up a couple of points.
In our case, you know, see, it is how you think about it even before you start. So we thought in terms of scale. We may not have used the word scale, but we were looking for solutions for a lot of people. So that was always at the back of our mind. So how you think and the attitude you bring and the sorts of questions you ask is very important, I found. And in our case, it was always about scale and large numbers. So whether that was realistic or not, that was the sort of cultural thinking at the back. Then, of course, it is how you execute. Now, in the case of Agastya, in terms of managing people, scale, there are a lot of challenges. How do you hire people? Can they execute? Can they not? India is a big country, different states, and all the rest of it. So one of the important things is the word trust, right? So my personal philosophy is, obviously, you can't do everything. We all know that. But you have to trust people to do the right thing, which means a decentralized management structure. Now, when you trust, there's no point trusting somebody and not training that person. They're going to fail. So trust combined with training, development, constant communication of the mission, and giving them the freedom to do and make mistakes. And often, you'll make a mistake. You know, you trusted somebody and they failed you in some way, shape, or form, and those things happen. So you shouldn't withdraw from that. You should continue doing that. Trust but verify, right? Trust but verify. So trusting, decentralization, communicating the mission in a simple, easy to understand way. For instance, we say curiosity, confidence, creativity. Another way of saying that is ah, aha, and ha-ha. So I found when we switched to ah, aha, ha-ha, people connected to it much faster. You know, it hit them here. So it became easier to communicate the mission, and so it became easier for them to actually go and execute. So it's a decentralized, trust-oriented environment that tries to encourage people to take initiative.
So first I'll answer the question about the weavers. That's a very, very important question. Now, it has been found that TB is rampant in certain professions. Those who are working in the carpet industry, those who are working in coal mines, those who are doing brass cutting and polishing in Moradabad, and of course Varanasi. Why? Because the fumes, the dust, the bits of fabric, the mines and the, you know, the cement factories, these are the areas where the lungs get choked, the immunity gets lowered, and lack of nutrition compounds the problem, and TB is rampant. So we have already started a beginning by working in Moradabad with the brass workers. We are looking forward to working in Varanasi, and I will be discussing with Mr. Modi to take the work to scale. The second point you mentioned is very valid, about the DOT centers and the government. Now, the government is majorly in denial as far as TB is concerned. And the reason is that millions of dollars have come into the country. The World Bank gave $170 billion in 2006, another $100 million, and another $100 million. The Global Fund gave $160 million. Where is all the money going? You see, it's not benefiting the poorest of the poor. And this is a question I've asked in the World Bank, that what's the point of all this funding if the people are not benefited? So on one hand, we have the excellent government infrastructure. We've got the doctors, the free medicines, the diagnostics. On the other hand, we have the poor patients who are suffering. So what I am doing effectively is to form a link between the poorest of the poor on one hand and the well-intended government infrastructure. So the patient doesn't go to the government clinic. If he goes for a lab test, he'll find the lab has not been open for 5 months. One of our donors went into the tribal areas and found the microscope was gathering dust and rusted. So what we do is we facilitate the process. We get the labs opened, we find out when the technician will be there, we take the patient on that day, and then that's how the work is done. So we have to effectively link it. And then the providers, the health workers, make friends with the government staff and tell them, bhai ye test kar lo varna mere paise mare jayenge. मेरे को 200 रुपए मिलेंगे अगर कोई पेशेंट का डायग्नोसिस होगा तुम तो मेरे पड़ोसी हो ना मेरे दोस्त हो एंड दिस इज व्हाट दे टेल द पेशेंट्स दवाई खा लो वरना मेरे पैसे मारे जाएंगे अब तो हमारे भाई बंधु हैं सो दिस इज हाउ वी डू इट वी फैसिलिटेट द प्रोसेस ऑफ लिंकिंग द पेशेंट्स विद द गवर्नमेंट एंड द सेकेंड क्वेश्चन वॉज ऑफ हाउ टू गो टू स्केल Okay, so that's a very, very important point. How do you go from one center, which we did, to go to scale? First things first, do things properly. We ran our first center for 6 months, understanding how TB treatment should be done. What are the issues we should address? How do we tackle stigma? How do we tackle the problem of patients not coming forward, going into denial, discriminating? Once we achieved that, we decided to go to scale. And in those 6 months, I personally connected with every single person and every single organization who could help me. And I was teaching global health issues in University of Chicago. I met up with a whole lot of university professors. They did fundraisers. They raised funds for us. And in India, my co-founder and colleague was an additional commissioner from the government. So he spoke at the same time with the government officials in the health ministry. We need to do TB treatment. So I got the funds, he got the connections, and the work got started. Then as you communicate, as one of the panelists has just said, you go across the world and talk about the work, people will invite you and someone will say, oh, you're using e-compliance in India, the fingerprinting. I think we need it in Afghanistan. And someone will give us funding to start work in Afghanistan. In Tanzania, we are working with a local NGO and an Ashoka Fellow, and the funding is coming from UK. So it's all about communication in a simple, effective manner. Find where is the need, find the right people, and then go to scale.
So Satya, I have a question for you. Right now, if anyone start within a 6 month, 5 minutes, they say, okay, right away, I want to pitch the people, get the investment, et cetera, et cetera. And somehow it's becoming like investment is the indicator of the success of the business. What comment?
Yeah, perhaps the bus has traveled further down the road. It's now looking like investment is the destination. And not even an indicator. I think the key thing I believe is that youngsters or whoever is a new entrepreneur should look at investments as a mix of something that eases the journey, but at the same time it brings in its own sets of pressures and challenges. And the person who invests money doesn't do that because he's got too much of money to give away. You know, we talk about even the NGOs, we need to be accountable and measurable in our results, as we know. So my suggestion or always advice to the entrepreneurs always is that stay focused on the purpose, use money frugally, especially in the initial stage until you've established your unit economics. Don't throw money at the problem. Throw your time at the problem, throw your skills at the problem, find a couple of good people who in your estimation are better than you in an area where you're very weak, and then let it work. That's why I find this innovation sandbox as a very powerful and practical way. Unless you master it in a sandbox, solve the problems, and then you can drag and drop and then scale it. Until that time, the money could actually be a detriment and not a enabling thing. You just need enough money to stay afloat and bring good resources to bear upon the problem. After that, when you're ready for scale, money will chase you. You don't need to chase the money. And as an entrepreneur, I've always felt that I would want an investor to talk to me from a position of respect towards me and not because he has a check to write. When he looks at me, looks at my company with respect, then we are in a better place to kind of engage with them.
One question, sir. Sir, myself, CA Jamuna Shukla, National Advisor, WES. I want to, sir, again to connect to this education system. I happen to go to some of these government schools, two, three schools. And there what I realize ki what the student ought to know in KG or first standard, they are not knowing even in fifth standard. And they are getting passed every year. We ask the teachers, they say ki kya kare ma'am? We are given so much of other works that we are not able to teach. We don't get time to teach them. These schools are mainly run for these midday meal only. The only purpose is being served to midday meal, and they are called the schools. And you know, all our real population which needs to be literate is connected to this government school only. So how can we solve this problem being in NGOs and all? We are going to some school, few schools, like sir said, being socialization and all. How this socialization can improve this system of education to make our India a real literate one? Thank you.
First of all, we have tremendous respect for what the work all the NGOs do. We fund a number of NGOs across India who are doing stellar work. But a hard fact I will share with you, you will never be able to change it bottoms up. You will never be able to. You can do work in 3 schools, 4 schools, 10 schools, but what you talked about is what is the teacher's job description. You cannot change it. It has to come from the system. The system has to change it for all the teachers across the state. Teachers' job description do not change school by school, and that is why we are extremely strong, you know, strongly we believe that government school system transformation definitely needs people like you to work at the grassroots, but has to be actually part of an entire systemic redesign. Without that, things will not move. I feel bad because we work with a number of NGOs who tell us exactly the same thing, but it is not going to change because that is the reason. In fact, it was very just one comment. Haryana's our project started when a very, very visionary and inspirational, I think, you know, IS officer, she came in as the education principal secretary of Haryana. She's now in the defense ministry in Delhi. She asked a very simple question. Why is it that for 60 years, hundreds and thousands of NGOs are trying so hard, but my state's education system is not changing? That made everybody, really speaking, that's the reason why this whole thing was designed, that you cannot change it. But that does not mean there is no role for you or organization. That is a very valuable. But alone, bottoms up, you will not be able to change it.
So, sir, something should be done. How can we do something?
You have to collaborate. Bring together. So it's not one NGO working in 3 schools. Will not. You have to build a coalition of NGOs, talk to the government, help. Or you might not, but at least force the government to develop a very detailed 3 to 5 years education transformation plan. And then you fit into that one. you cannot do it by yourself. That's really speaking the reality of the case.
Thank you, Devashish. We have a breakup session also, and we can talk to the more in smaller group to the planner sitting here. And by that note, I would like to conclude the session. It's wonderful listening all of you, and thank you, everyone.